What we've done is I've got a radiation source which is emitting a constant stream of electrons. As neutrons are decaying into protons, out pops an electron, and I'm counting how many of those, not how many it's giving out, but how many of them are going into the Geiger counter. That's a slightly different number. Okay.
And what kind of ballpark figures are we talking here?
Well, you
must know. Cause you
yes, so it's about 20 per second going into the Geiger counter. And then I'm feeding that into this little box, which is just turning that number into a voltage. So these two wires are collecting that voltage, and they're passing them into the oscilloscope, where we can see the pulses as they go by. Each pulse represents one electron. And electrons are all the same, so those pulses are all the same height, right? And so as those pulses flash by, I'm counting them. The computer is counting them. So the wire comes out of the oscilloscope, it goes through this little breakout box and into the back of the computer. You can buy one of these things for about 200 quid, by the way. They're worth having, right? Into the back of the computer. And then I've written a little computer program. And all the computer program does is sit there for 10 seconds and count pulses. That's it. It's really simple. It's all graphs today, right? Here's time along here. And the stream of electrons look something like this as they're coming out. And they're randomly distributed, which my stream of electrons absolutely isn't there. It's getting less random by the second. Right? And all I'm doing is I'm counting. So I start with a value of 0. And then I get to this time, and I'm adding 1. I get here, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and so on. Right? And this is where the probability bit comes in, because the chances are that over 10 seconds, remember this graph? So the most likely number that we're going to get here, I measured this morning, is 216.
Over 10 seconds.
Over 10 seconds, right? Okay, and that's just an empirical measurement. So I'm taking the number that I've counted up, and I'm going to subtract off 216. What we've just seen then, where the answer was 13, then obviously either I've come in here, and I'm going to get this right, I've had 229, or it could equally be that I've been here and had 203. Both of those are going to give the answer of 13. So the reason that's happened is I wasn't interested in showing you a negative random number. I wanted to show you an integer value, a positive integer value. Yeah, so I just wrote a piece of software where I squared it up. I took the square root, the square root's inevitably positive, and so my software is always going to give a positive answer. I cheated, all right? Okay, I admit it, I cheated. But the answer is 13. So you want some more numbers, right? Okay, well, I'll generate a few more.
Let's do 10 and write them down as they come out.
All right, yeah, good idea.
Sorry, I got it. Oh, big one. Or is that big? We don't know yet.
We don't know yet. So, well, should we start with the 0 and the 13?
Do you want, right?
Or do you want to just start with a 13?
No, put them. So we've got a 0, a 13.
So we have had a 0. We've had 13. Now we have 27. 5. The number 5.
They should do the lottery like this.
They really should use radiation sources for the lottery. Nobody would be cheating, for sure. It doesn't quite have the razzmatazz of the lottery. 44. Last seen 3 weeks ago today.
But hang on a second. This would be a bad way to do the lottery because some numbers here are more likely than other ones.
Right. So that's a really good point that you've made. There's some maths which I left out of this video because I thought it was going too far, where you can turn a Gaussian distribution into a uniform distribution. So you can take your Gaussian distribution of random numbers and you can flip it around and give them all a uniform probability. Okay? Now, I don't want to do the maths for you because that'd be painful for everybody, but it works. And so you can then generate a uniform probability sequence of numbers.
But we haven't done that.
That's absolutely not what we've done. No, what we've done is we've taken a Gaussian distribution, and so some numbers, 0 basically, are going to be more likely than others. I'm really quite enjoying this. It's very satisfying. 3. Okay. I'll run another one. We'll count up. So the computer again is counting 200-ish electrons, and this is the deviation. 6 is the deviation from the mean. And because it's got a Gaussian distribution, the smaller numbers are more probable. So if we keep doing this, what we're going to end up with is very heavily weighted to the small numbers, right? It's actually quite surprising to me that we haven't seen zero again yet. I should say this morning, 9, excellent. This morning before you arrived, I ran thousands of these just to check that it was Gaussian, not that nature was suddenly going to do something different. So the computer is counting the number of electrons that strontium is putting out, and in this case, it's either put out 20 more than the average number of electrons, or it's put out 20 less. I can't tell because I've hidden that in my code, but it's 20 away from the average. So in the science of statistics, this is 10, excellent. In the science of statistics, yeah, sorry.
It's all right. You have George, you need something?
On your head be it, George, thank you. 19. So that's 19 more or less electrons than the average value that the strontium's putting out. So in this case, it's been quite an active 10 seconds for the strontium. Okay, 13.
Oh, we got 13 again. We haven't got a zero again.
No, that's surprising. Anyway, so this is the truth of it. It could well be that I got the mean in the wrong place. So that would explain. And eventually that would show up. So there's one last thing I'd like to show you, and that is essentially, well, let me just show you and then I can talk about it, right? I'm going to run the experiment 1,000 times over. And let me make that nice and big. So each one of these pulses that you can see appearing, that's one number that we've generated. Okay? And as you can see, we're generating more and more numbers. And each time I'm adding one to this pulse. And so the most likely number at the moment is 20.
It's not zero. What does this tell us?
This tells us that I got the mean wrong. Okay, so if I'd got the mean right, then this value would be zero. Okay, what this means is that I got the mean wrong by probably by 20, which is...
The mean being what?
What this means is that I got the mean number of electrons that this thing's giving out in 10 seconds. I got that completely wrong. Which is a bit embarrassing. But you can see now that it's starting to take this Gaussian form. So it started off just as a couple of pulses, and you'd never have known that there was a Gaussian distribution to that. But over time, it grows into a really nice bell-shaped graph, and we can see that the most likely number that we're going to generate has moved up a bit from 20 now. It's about 22.
That also means when we ran the experiment earlier and we got zero as our first result, that was actually quite an unlikely result.
Yep, absolutely. So that would mean that effectively zero was more like a 20 result, and all of the 20s and 19s that we got and the 27 that we got before, these were much more likely. It wasn't perfect, but it was all right, I think, and I think that we got a nice random number from it, so I'm pretty pleased.
So that was still random. This doesn't affect the randomness of the numbers.
No. I mean, again, this goes back to the semantics of it, right? This is it, it's random, yes, but it has a particular probability associated with choosing that number. So at the moment, the probability of choosing something less than about 8 is 0, and the probability of choosing something more than 38 is 0. If we go for a very, very long time, an infinitely long time, then these numbers will become non-zero, but they're going to be very close to zero.
Oh, you've got a little outlier there, now near 40, don't we?
Yeah, it's quite satisfying just watching this graph draw itself over time. Question is, how much time do you have?